JP, you are not new to the Lightspeed team, but new to this role. Give us an idea of where you plan to take Lightspeed and words of wisdom from the outgoing CEO, Dax da Silva.
Yes, good morning, Larissa. So yes, I mean, I've been in the company for 10 years. Dax and I, I always said internally, two sides of the same coin. So I think it's both our babies. We've been all the acquisitions, the strategy, we've been really working together. So I think with this in mind, I really love, the legacy. Obviously, Dax leaves. I fundamentally believe in our strategy, our vision, and what we're trying to put in place. So I think for me, the big focus is, there are three in the coming, call it the coming year. The first one is really strong product strategy, strong product roadmaps. We've made it very clear that we wanted to now go upstream and integrate suppliers, stores, and consumers. So I think it's very important for me that we deliver on this. There's a number of new products that are coming out. We have large R&D teams. And so I think for me, we understand the focus there, but we need to deliver within the coming quarters. And a lot actually is going to happen in the next 90 days. So here, very focused on launching these new products. Number two, I think, is people. Sure, we have 300 openings on our website right now. We're a high-growth company. Our last quarter, we grew 74% organically year-over-year. So for me, when I think about people, it's more the contributors of today need to become the leaders of tomorrow as we're going to continue growing, and we don't see any limit in where we're heading. So ensuring that we continue to grow our people and also ensure that the people we hire, I always say are missionaries and not, and that they're here for the right reasons, that they really care about small businesses. So ensuring that we just continue to hire amazing people in the company. And the third thing, and not the least, is to reach all of our, financial commitments. So we've announced to the markets that we're going to be growing at least between 35%-40% in the next few years. Want to be sure that we continue to grow, we continue to deliver on the expectations. And really, path to profitability is a big theme now. And we've always said, as we continue to grow, and of course, our cost base is not growing at the same rate as our revenues. We're bound to cross the path between, making losses and making profits. So here, just ensuring that we have that path to profitability in the coming years is very important for me.
I want to pick up on a few things that you had said, but I want to just go back a little bit and give us an idea of what happens to a company when you are hit with this kind of news, this accusation that you are misleading investors. I mean, it really hurt Lightspeed considerably. Give us an idea of what happens when news like that came out and hit you.
Well, I mean, obviously there's the internal emotions where you're like, we've put so much energy and pride to build this wonderful company, and we've always been transparent, and we've always deeply cared about our investors. And I think, again, and so when you hear these accusations, it's very hurtful. But I think we were very clear. Those allegations are 100% wrong. There's not one single point in that report that has any right to be there. And I think it's maybe the randoms of success. But anyway, it's been very hurtful. But I think for me, it's more about, look, we have an amazing company. We're creating a ton of value for our customers. We just got to continue, and we got to plow forward. Of course, the stock has reacted very negatively to this. But I think for me, the stock is a short-term perception of long-term value that we're creating. So I think for me, it's more about just continuing to focus on the right things. As you've seen last quarter, 74% organically when we're 3,000 employees. I mean, we're still growing, at a startup rate, being a very scaled company and a scaled-up company. So I think the only way to get out of this is just to continue building a great company and just, continuing delivering value to our customers and our shareholders.
One of the biggest ways probably that you've done that in the past is with acquisitions. Your growth was very much tied to the acquisitions since you made your, I guess, public debut in 2019. Correct me if I'm mistaken, it was something like 13 acquisitions by the end of 2021. Is that still the plan going forward? I mean, I want to go back and pick up on something that you had said, that You have news coming out within the next 90 days. Are those some of the things that you will be announcing?
Yeah, so maybe just talking about the acquisitions. Our growth has always been very strong organically. So it's not like we're making acquisitions to offset. Even when we've always had high growth and organic growth in the company. And so that's why when I say 74% last quarter, that's the organic piece. If you look at non-organically with the acquisitions, it's 156%. But so again, just wanted to make it very clear that we're not doing these acquisitions because we think that, you know, that's going to offset. Our company's always been a high growth company, and these acquisitions have always been made to have a very strong product strategy. So, when you want to build, you always have this question around build internally or buy or partner. And we made these acquisitions because we wanted to accelerate our growth, and we wanted to accelerate our capabilities in terms of what we brought to our customers. So I think just wanted to make that point clear. Now, to answer your question, we've acquired in the last year and a half, seven or eight companies. So we are digesting right now. We're in a phase where we're continuing to integrate. And I think that also has to do with the change in Dax's role and my role is really right now, it's, you know, ruthless execution of our operations and ensuring that everything gets integrated. As we go forward, when I talk about these products that we're launching in the coming quarters, these are actually the result of these acquisitions. We're integrating all of these acquisitions and building new products on top of them. And so this is more internal, again, has nothing to do with us going out and buying companies on the market. It's really our ability to integrate those businesses and create new products from components that we've acquired. And doing very well, we announced a month ago that we launched our hospitality product in North America. We're very pleased with the results there. And there's still a lot to do in terms of our capabilities. And the last piece of what we're launching in the coming quarters is really continuing to expand our payment capabilities, because that's very important for us, financially, because a customer with payments has 10 times the revenues as a customer without our payment solution. So we got to continue to deploy this platform globally, but not related to any acquisitions.
As the world moves forward towards some kind of an end of this pandemic, there's been this notion that perhaps e-commerce will take a backseat to bricks and mortar. That must run through your conversations in the boardroom.
Yes, and actually this is all very good news for us. So the vast majority of Lightspeed's business is not e-commerce. The large majority of what we do is actually helping restaurateurs and retailers in cities and communities around the world. So even though we're growing at 74% in a pandemic world, call it, with Omicron that harmed us, the post-pandemic world is going to be an accelerator for us. And it's going to create a ton of tailwinds because, as you all know, we all can't wait to get back to restaurants and get back to, living the life and, getting away from our Zooms. And that's really going to have a very strong positive impact on Lightspeed. So unlike a pure e-commerce company, the going back to a physical world is only good news for Lightspeed.